1, focus on what you can control. In the intricate tapestry of life, external events often unfold beyond our sphere of influence. Stoicism teaches us the invaluable lesson of discerning between what lies within our control and what doesn't. As Marcus Aurelius astutely noted, you have power over your mind, not outside events. Realize this and you will find strength. Understanding this distinction liberates us from the shackles of frustration and anxiety. In our daily lives, traffic jams, weather fluctuations, or the opinions of others are circumstances beyond our command. However, our responses, attitudes, and interpretations are entirely within our jurisdiction. By channeling our energies toward managing our internal reactions instead of futilely attempting to alter external realities, we reclaim a profound sense of agency over our lives. This Stoic insight encourages us to focus on nurturing our mental and emotional well-being, fostering resilience in the face of life's uncertainties. Rule number 2, practice virtue. Virtue, the cornerstone of Stoic philosophy, serves as a guiding beacon in our quest for a meaningful existence. Marcus Aurelius elucidated this principle eloquently, stating, "Very little is needed to make a happy life. It is all within yourself, in your way of thinking." True happiness, according to Stoicism, emanates from the cultivation of wisdom, courage, justice, and temperance. These cardinal virtues shape our actions, leading us toward a life of moral integrity and fulfillment. Practicing virtue involves making conscious choices aligned with these principles, both in our personal and professional realms. It means exercising empathy when others falter, displaying courage in the face of adversity, and upholding justice even when no one is watching. Virtuous actions ripple through our lives, leaving a trail of positive influence on those we encounter. By embracing these virtues, we not only enhance our own well-being, but also contribute to the betterment of the world around us. Rule number 3, in accordance with nature. The Stoic philosophy, rooted in the wisdom of nature, emphasizes the importance of aligning our lives with the natural order of the universe. Marcus Aurelius, in his meditative reflections, observed, "The best revenge is to be unlike him who performed the injustice." This profound insight urges us to embrace the impermanence of life and respond to injustices or adversities with equanimity and grace. Nature, in its ceaseless cycles of birth and decay, teaches us the inevitability of change. By acknowledging this universal truth, we liberate ourselves from the shackles of attachment and resentment. In the face of life's challenges, adopting a Stoic mindset allows us to navigate turbulent waters with tranquility. By appreciating the transience of material possessions and societal expectations, we find solace in simplicity, experiencing a profound sense of contentment that transcends the ephemeral nature of external circumstances. Rule number 4, develop inner strength. Inner strength, the bedrock of emotional resilience, empowers us to face life's tribulations with poise and determination. Marcus Aurelius, in his profound wisdom, remarked, "Our life is what our thoughts make it." This Stoic insight encapsulates the essence of cultivating a robust inner world. In the face of setbacks, be they personal or professional, maintaining a calm and composed mindset becomes our greatest asset. Resilience is not the absence of adversity, but the ability to confront challenges with patience and perseverance. A Stoic approach encourages us to view setbacks not as insurmountable obstacles, but as opportunities for personal growth and transformation. When we encounter difficulties, our thoughts shape our reactions. By embracing challenges as catalysts for self-improvement, we forge an unshakable mental fortitude. This inner strength enables us to weather life's storms, emerging stronger, wiser, and more compassionate. Rule number 5, be mindful of the present moment. The art of mindfulness, rooted in the teaching, invites us to immerse ourselves fully in the present moment. Marcus Aurelius sagely noted, "Very little is needed to make a happy life. It is all within yourself, in your way of thinking." In our fast-paced, digitally dominated era, the present often eludes us as our minds wander between the regrets of the past and the anxieties of the future. Stoicism advocates for embracing the richness of each moment, acknowledging its fleeting beauty. By cultivating mindfulness, we learn to savor the sensory delights of the present, the warmth of sunlight, the aroma of freshly brewed coffee, the laughter of loved ones. This heightened awareness fosters gratitude, infusing ordinary moments with extraordinary significance. In the mindful embrace of the present, we discover an oasis of peace, untainted by the worries of yesterday or the uncertainties of tomorrow. Through the practice of mindfulness, we learn to anchor ourselves in the here and now, experiencing life's tapestry in all its vivid colors and nuances. Rule number 6, practice self-reflection. Self-reflection, a cherished practice in Stoicism, serves as a gateway to self-discovery and personal transformation. Marcus Aurelius, in his contemplative wisdom, shared, "Dwell on the beauty of life, watch the stars, and see yourself running with them." Self-reflection invites us to delve deep within, exploring the recesses of our thoughts, emotions, and beliefs. In the gentle light of self-awareness, we illuminate the shadows of our fears and desires. Regular introspection grants us a profound understanding of our inner landscape, allowing us to identify patterns of behavior and thought. By journaling our reflections or embracing meditation, we embark on a journey of self-discovery, peeling away the layers of conditioning to reveal our authentic selves. Through this process, we gain insights into our aspirations, fears, and motivations, enabling us to make conscious choices aligned with our truest values. Self-reflection, as advocated by Stoicism, becomes the compass guiding
us. Hi, buddy. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, my friend. You, Hare Krishna, my friend. We will be friends till the end. We are the champions. Where's your family? Where's your family? Go bring family. Go bring family. Bring your family. Three. Bring all three of them.
We sow the seeds of positivity and harmony. Virtuous actions are not mere.
All right. You want an egg? Come here. Come to me. Come with me, my love, to the sea of love. I wanna tell you how much I love you. Ooh, ooh. Come with me, my love, to the sea of love. I wanna tell you, this is nice, how much I love you. Come on, baby. Hare Krishna, Jivja go. Yeah, come here. Come on, baby. Come on. Come on.
vedi? Baby. Thank you.
Thank you.
Come on, baby. Come on. Cheers.
Baby. Хобби у меня такое, кормлю ворон по утрам. Вечерами сжигаюсь толстыми тетками. По утрам я кормлю ворон. А, excuse me. No excuse. Вороны это мои друзья. Что-то третья нету. Обычно прилетает вот этот, прилетает ворон, это который сейчас песню поет. Спасибо, говорят, за яйца, за ветчину, за хлебушек. Но обычно вот этот прилетает ворон первый, потом он улетает на 2 минуты, прилетает еще 2-3. Не знаю, может, семья у них 3 человека, но один, наверное, загнулся. Потому что много месяцев втроем были. Ну, обычно ну, ветчину беру, яйца, прилетит, поест. А когда поест, хлеба нет, больше яйца будет. Ищенку мы любим. Васятка любит ищенку. Ищенка вкусная, кушаешь еще хочется прямо. На тебе там ищенку. Или уже зажрался совсем. Совсем зажрался, уже яишенку не хочет. Вкусно? Ой-ой-ой, поймал, пошел. Но сегодня солнца нету, а когда солнце он берет и улетает в тень. Потому что они черные, на солнце моментально нагреваются, тоже не дураки. Берет еду, улетает за угол, садится в тенечке. И в тенечке садится и кушает. А мне сейчас пора уже крутить педали, пока меня не дали. давай, спой, Светик, не стыдись. Я знаю, ты хорошо поешь. Проклятая Колыма. А там сзади бегает злодей. Я-то кормлю сорок, а тот злодей тоже прилетает, хочет на шару, типа, зацепить ветчинки с Юшенкой. Но они не дают. Он пошел лазить по моей, топтаться по моей куртке. Эй, вали оттуда, сейчас еще насеришь. Вали с моей куртки. Дядя, а что у тебя в голове? Нахера тебе моя жилетка? Что ты по ней топчешься? Ага. Васёк. Ты хоть жилеточку на мелике, на велосипед там, может, не выйдет? Может, не выйдет? Давай, валяй. Вали, как он сказал. Я знаю, ты топчешься, но пока всё.
Добрый день, мы с Украины, и я рад приветствовать вас на своем канале. И как обычно, по традиции, мы с вами начинаем видеообзор по оперативной обстановке за прошедшие сутки. А сегодня на календаре у нас 8 ноября. И начинаем мы, как уже по сложившейся традиции, это огромное благодарности всем, кто поддерживает проект волонтерского фонда «Мирстан-Земля» на донатами на закупку комплектующих и производство дронов последующих отправ
simplicity lies a depth of wisdom that philosophers and thinkers have explored and expounded upon for millennia. At its core, this phrase isn't about indifference or defeat. It's about recognition, recognizing the innate nature of a situation, of an emotion, of a challenge. It's a bridge that spans the gap between expectation and reality. When we utter these words, we're not shrugging off responsibility or giving up hope. We're grounding ourselves in the present, shedding the weight of what if and if only. Throughout history, many have delved into this very principle. Stoic philosophers in ancient Greece emphasized the importance of discerning between what we can control and what we cannot, urging us to invest our energies wisely. Eastern philosophies often echo similar sentiments, guiding disciples to flow like water, to adapt, to find peace not by reshaping the world around them, but by reshaping their perceptions and reactions. It's captivating to realize that while our modern world seems vastly different from the eras of Epictetus or Lao Tzu, the essence of human experience remains remarkably consistent. We have always sought peace, understanding, and a way to navigate the tumultuous seas of existence. And across cultures, epochs, and ideologies, the philosophy of acceptance emerges as a beacon. Yet, understanding the depth and breadth of this philosophy requires more than just nodding at a popular phrase. It beckons a journey through time, thought, and introspection. To embrace the art of acceptance is to weave the lessons of great thinkers, from Stoic philosophers to modern psychologists, into the very fabric of our existence. As we embark on this journey together, let's dive deeper into the realm of acceptance. Through the lenses of luminaries who've graced our world, we'll explore the true essence of acceptance, its transformative power, and the serenity it promises to those who truly comprehend and practice it. Men are disturbed not by things, but by the views which they take of them. Epictetus. Born into the harsh confines of servitude, Epictetus's life as a slave would be far from what many might consider. Yet from these very confines sprouted a philosophy so profound that its reverberations continue to shape our understanding of acceptance and control to this day. A limping figure, a consequence of his leg being broken by his master, Epictetus eventually gained his freedom. He would later set up a school in Nicopolis, teaching a philosophy that often pivoted on the dynamics of control. At the heart of his teachings lies the profound differentiation between things we can control and things we cannot. This demarcation is not just an observation, but a tool, a compass, if you will, for navigating the often tumultuous waters of existence. Imagine standing at the edge of a vast, swirling ocean. The waves crash against the shore, each with its force, rhythm, and direction. You stand there with a bucket hoping to direct the tide. A fool's errand, you might say, and you'd be right. This is how many of us live our lives, attempting to steer the vast and uncontrollable forces around us, inevitably leading to frustration, disappointment, and often despair. Instead, focus on the bucket, how you hold it, when you choose to fill it, and where you pour the water, that's within your grasp. Men are disturbed not by things, but by the views which they take of them. This quote crystallizes Epictetus' philosophy beautifully. It's not the external events, but our perceptions and judgments about them that unsettle us. The death of a loved one, the loss of a job, or even something as mundane as a passing comment from a stranger, these events in themselves are neutral. They become agents of joy, sorrow, anger, or indifference based on the interpretations we bestow upon them. But here's where it becomes transformative. If our judgments disturb us more than the events themselves, then doesn't it follow that we have the power to choose our reactions? This isn't about deluding oneself or painting a facade of positivity over everything. It's about understanding the inherent nature of events as indifference, and then recognizing our capacity. can't command the weather, we can choose to carry an umbrella. While we can't decide the actions of another, we can decide our response. While we can't always dictate the outcome, we can always control the effort. What's intriguing is how this philosophy is not just a passive acceptance, but an active engagement with life. It's about taking responsibility for our domain, the internal realm of our thoughts, feelings, and decisions. It's about recognizing that while we cannot dance to the whims of fate, we can choose the steps we take, the rhythm we adopt, and the grace with which we move. Adopting such a mindset can be transformative. Consider the daily irritations and stresses that we encounter. Traffic jams, an unkind word, a delay in plans. All these can spiral into torrents of distress if we let them. But what if, heeding Epictetus' words, we pause and ask ourselves, is this within my control? If it isn't, can we then refocus our energy on what is? Our response, our attitude, our next move. In today's world, where we're inundated with information, where challenges seem multifaceted and often overwhelming, the wisdom of a former slave from ancient Rome seems more pertinent than ever. By delineating the boundaries of our control, we don't restrict ourselves, we empower ourselves. We find clarity, purpose, and importantly, serenity. As we reflect on Epictetus' teaching, it's an invitation. An invitation to engage with the world not as hapless victims of circumstance, but as empowered individuals, ever ready, ever resilient, capable of finding tranquility amidst the storm. Because in understanding what we can and cannot change, we uncover the art of true acceptance, a dance of grace in the face of life's ever-changing circumstances.
Bye, bye.
Life is a series of natural and spontaneous changes. Don't resist them. That only creates sorrow. Let reality be reality. Loud
salt.
Glimmers of wisdom often find their source in ancient civilizations, where spiritual sages, in their communion with nature, deciphered the rhythms and patterns of existence. Among such luminaries was Lao Tzu, a mystic whose name translates to the old master. Though shrouded in layers of myth and time, his insights form the cornerstone of Taoism, a philosophy and spiritual path that emphasizes living in harmony with the Tao, often translated as the way. Imagine, if you will, standing at the edge of a serene river, its waters flowing gently, moving around rocks and bends, never rushing, never dallying, but always unfailingly reaching its destination. This imagery captures the essence of Taoism. It suggests that life, much like that river, has its current, its natural flow, and our journey becomes harmonious when we align ourselves with this flow rather than resist it. This brings us to the concept of wu-wei. Translated as non-doing or non-action, it doesn't advocate for inactivity or passiveness. Instead, it is the art of effortless action, of acting without forcing, of letting things unfold naturally, without imposition or opposition. A tree doesn't strive to grow, it simply grows. A bird doesn't struggle to fly, it just flies. Nature doesn't labor, it simply is. This is the essence of wu-wei. In our lives, when we're constantly pushing, forcing, and striving, we might achieve short-term victories, but they often come at the cost of inner peace and long-term sustainability. Wu-wei encourages us to approach life with a sense of trust in the natural order, and act when necessary, but without unnecessary force and struggle. In a world where change is the only constant, we are ourselves granting these natural shifts. Whether whether it's an unexpected life event, a sudden shift in plans, or even the inexorable march of time. Resisting these changes is like attempting to halt the river's flow with our bare hands, not only futile, but also exhausting. This doesn't imply passivity or resignation. Quite the contrary. Flowing with the Tao, practicing Wu Wei, means being acutely attuned to the situation, understanding when to act and when to wait, when to speak and when to remain silent. It's a dance, sometimes leading, sometimes following, but always in tune with the music of existence. In the context of our modern world, with its...
I'm driving car and I got disability sticker. So in 1 hour, how long I can park in 1 hour?
1 hour or more, you can say it's not a
Minimum. There's another question. If it's a parking zone, can I park in the parking?
That's what I mean. It's got to be normal parking. You can't park in no stopping, no.
So I cannot park here?
You can park here, normal parking here. Where it's green, and then the green zone.
Even it's a ticket then?
Yeah, green zone.
So this disability is free?
Yeah.
Chris. Morning, John. Morning, Marimba. Morning. Are you going up?
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Join me. Come with me, my love. To the sea, of love.
Yes, Felix.
I can tell you how much I love you.
Good song.
It's a good song. You know this song?
Yeah.
You know who's the singer?
Yes, Felix.
You know who's the singer? Mm. It's a girls band.
Girls
Come
band.
With me, my love, to the sea of love. I wanna tell you how much.